Yeah, can you see my screen now?
Yes, sir, we can see it.
Okay.
Just 1 minute, sir, we'll start.
Yeah, sure.
Hi, sir. Good morning, dear participants. Welcome back to the second session of today. It will be handed by Dr. C.R. Bannur, sir. I now call upon Professor Lakshmi to introduce the speaker to the participants, please. Madam.
Good morning, everyone. It's a great pleasure for me to introduce our speaker, who is accomplished, strategic, experienced, and versatile technology leader, Dr. C.R. Bannur, sir, now here to talk about innovative technologies for smart and safe cities. He holds PhD in GIS and remote sensing with vast expertise in geostatistics and data analytics. He started his career as research scholar and worked as scientist in institutions such as Karnataka State Remote Sensing Center, initiated by the Department of Space, Government of India, and R&D Center, ASCST, and IASC Bangalore. He served in the corporate sector as head of technical marketing and pre-scale division, Vice President, Senior Director, and as Product Head for Defense and Security Solutions. Currently, he is working as Chief Consulting Advisor in Jio Raksha Consulting, Mumbai. He has worked both in government and corporate sector and excelled in his career as scientist, consultant, Jio IT solution strategist, and Product Head for multidisciplinary domains such as environment, utilities, and communications, including transportation, defense, and homeland security. His contributions includes development and deployment of various geo-enabled decision support system for World Bank-funded projects to manage water resources and environment, GIS-based asset management system for mining areas and utility companies, innovative command and control systems, emergency response and asset management system for smart and safe cities. He has recognized as the member of several national-level committees, including the National GIS Core Group Planning Commission, Government of India. He worked as the senior consultant for SDI Strategic Defense Initiative in Middle East, GIS standards for Road and Transport Authority Dubai, carrying capacity for Coastal Karnataka, as principal investigator for national level programs such as National Resource Data Management System, that is NRDMS, initiated by Department of Science and Technology, Government of India, and as senior consultant in various World Bank and United Nations Development Program funded projects. We are very happy to have you for the session, sir. Over to you. Thank you.
Hi. Good morning to all. Hope I am audible.
Yes, sir, you're audible.
Yeah, okay. So thanks for a nice introduction and grateful to the organizers for giving me an opportunity to present some of my thoughts about innovative technologies for smart and safe cities. Well, when we say innovative technologies, there are so many technologies, both in IT as well as in geospatial technology and also in the electronic domain. So in today's world, as a part of smart and safe city, various projects are being implemented. And also as a part of smart and safe city, they are trying to leverage on existing systems which are already there, or systems in the sense, you know, from the past two decades when the information technology was evolved, various systems were implemented, maybe from utility perspective or to provide best infrastructure, smart infrastructure, and so on. But they all exist in silos. So under this initiative, attempts are being made to integrate these technologies also. So I'm going to touch upon some of those technologies, both from academic perspective as well as from the professional perspective. So here I am touching upon three core fundamental technologies. One is, of course, geospatial or GIS technologies, which you are already familiar with, because I was told there was one particular session in which a very detailed GIS presentation was held. Then also about the modern information technology and the communication technology. Well, so the big question is, why smart and safe cities? As you are aware, due to rapid urbanization, we are having very limited space and infrastructure, and as a result, you will find traffic congestion along the highways and roads. And for decision makers and government bodies, it is very difficult to provide a citizen-centric services. And in addition to that, you will find some environmental hazards also. The environmental hazards include natural disasters, maybe flood or earthquake or tsunamis, or sometimes man-made disasters like a fire may happen, or there will be some antisocial activities and anti-national activities. So there are many challenges which are there, for especially for the metro cities and major cities. So it is important for the decision makers to detect any incidences that are happening, whether it is something to do with the lack of service in the citizen center, a citizen service center, or it may be environmental hazard, or it may be earthquake, or it may be drug trafficking, or it may be act of terrorism also. So once if these are detected, then one has to analyze to prevent or to respond to minimize the damage, or response to provide a better services. So keeping this in mind, the whole smart and safe city concept was evolved. Now, decision makers, are you as a engineers or a geospecialists or IT specialists, are aware that implementation of any project includes a planning, design, build, then operate and maintain it. So you have a major role to play. It can be anything that is related to infrastructure for societal growth. So what is the infrastructure? You know, infrastructure is a huge word. Infrastructure can be your water supply network, infrastructure can be your power supply network, infrastructure can be your critical infrastructures like, you know, some of the major industries, so on and so forth. So whenever these are the targets of certain incidences, incidences can be, as I said, it can be a fire, it can be attacked by a terrorist, or it can be accident on a road. So whenever such incidents happens, one should be able to provide a better response and analyze the things in a short notice. So how is that short notice one can address is what the fundamental principles of, I would say, smart and safe city concept. Now, if you look at the definitions of smart city or safe city, there are so many definitions, because across the globe, smart city is implemented to address a specific needs. Whatever technologies we talk about may not be suitable for one particular city, but the combination of various technologies which are relevant to address the location specific problems is what are being implemented. So accordingly, people have, you know, the scientists or the experts have come out with various definitions. Now, I will not touch upon each. I will not go through each and every definitions of smart city and safe city. But in my opinion, what is smart city is, it's a framework that ensures sustainable economic development, and also people should feel safe and secure by leveraging on the state-of-the-art innovative technologies that which are existing today. Again, maybe it is in the electronic domain, or it is in the communication domain, or it can be in the information technology itself. So these are the three pillars. One is the sensors. Second one is geospatial technologies for smart city. And third one is information technology and communication technology. When all these technologies are combined to address the specific problems being faced in the city is what will give you a smarter, safe city. So I will go walk you through some of the use case scenarios. What do we really mean by all this integrated solution approach? So we have sensors. There are many sensors. Sensors may be weather sensors, or they may be a rainfall or water level sensors. So these sensors will enable the decision makers to detect, so that one can try to prevent or prepare themselves. Now, when we say prepare themselves, then one has to leverage on various technologies, that is maybe information technologies like management information system to monitor and analyze, or emergency response systems like Dial 100, or mobile-based systems, or in case when the response has to be provided, then there is a need to establish emergency operation center at a district level, state level, depending upon how the smart and safe city is being visualized. But right now the major challenge in our country as well as across the globe is there are many systems which have been already implemented. And what is important as a part of smart and safe city is integration of all these technologies with the command and control systems. How really that will enable the decision makers to implement the better response is what we can see in the forthcoming slides. So I talked about GIS. You are already quite familiar. What is GIS? Basically, GIS talks about location, like, okay, what is it at a particular location, or where exactly the incidents has happened. And this is very important because, you know, unless we know the location where the, let us say, the water supply pipe has busted, or let us say where exactly the bomb blast has happened, or let us say where exactly some murder has taken place. So there are so many incidences which our administrators on day-to-day basis will be facing. So that location, what is that at a particular location is important, so that they can send the response team there. And geospatial technology will also enable you to analyze the conditions. The conditions means what is the surroundings of that, what infrastructure exists. For example, if there is a fire, okay, how many hospitals are there in the vicinity of that particular incidents, and how many water hydrants are available in that in the vicinity of that particular incidents is what the GIS can provide you. And also about the trends and patterns one can analyze. And this is very powerful tool, the geospatial technology, because it also allow you to do certain modeling, what if else then scenario kind of a things. So what if this incident has happened at a particular location, then what should be the remedy? Because again, the remedies are also very, very specific. So that's why the GIS is one of the major component in any smart and safe city initiatives. So I will not talk about the definitions of GIS, which you have already gone through. But what is most important is, what is the data required and what is the source of the data needed to build a very good smart and safe city? Well, as you are aware, most of the geospatial systems needs data pertaining to contour maps or terrain data, and also administrative boundary maps, infrastructure such as transportation network, road network, then land use, land cover maybe. And if somebody is working on, let us say, groundwater modeling, as a part of Smart City Initiative, they would need drainage maps and soil maps and many more. I mean, there is no, and there are so many thematic layers available, which are being generated by many data generating agencies. And each of this data will have its own corresponding attributes. So if you look at, so where should I look at the data? Data can, I mean, if you are doing some project, definitely you would need a lot of data, and everything cannot be generated. For example, contour map and the base layer, such as a road map, drainage maps, cannot be generated every time. Such data will be available with the Survey of India, and some thematic layers are available with the NRSS, and it is being provided through portals such as Bhuvan, and Google is also one of the source. So we call them basically as a map providers. But for specific projects, you would need a specific data also. So that data, as a civil engineer or as a surveyor, one can collect the data and use it to build their application required for a smart and safe city. But today, this data is available, as I said, in various, with various agencies, because as I said, there are many data generating agencies, and when these data generating agencies generate the data, maybe the source of the data will be from the surveying, I mean, traditional surveying, or it may be from the satellite remote sensing data. But the data is available in the digital format, but in various formats. So when I say various format, let us say if it is NRSA, they are leveraging on ISRI technologies, and traditionally Department of Space was an ArcGIS, now it is the ArcGIS server, and they have a very good repository of land use, soil map and hydrology maps, etc. And Survey of India, of course, they have also have in traditional format, like traditional data format was DGN, that was a microstation DGN. I believe now they have migrated to a new format. They have come out with their own standards also. And there is a, what is called as in the national level, the project that was implemented as a national spatial data infrastructure. This was expected to be a gateway for the map users or thematic users who are interested to make use of thematic maps for various applications. So they can search the metadata, retrieve the metadata from these servers and use it for their applications. Now, in addition to this, what is important is also the some attribute information or the infrastructure data. So there are again so many agencies, like, you know, Ministry of Commerce and Industry is maintaining industry data, and the Census of India is maintaining demographic data. Education Department will have the educational facilities, and Ministry of Agriculture will have their own agriculture data. And we also have a National Informatics, which is maintaining some data related to the infrastructure being implemented as a part of some government schemes. But here is the challenge from a smart and safe city perspective. The challenge is all these data are available in different formats. For example, if Ministry of Commerce and Industry, this is just an example I am giving. If the Ministry of Commerce and Industry is maintaining the data, they may be maintaining in Oracle, or Census may be maintaining in SQL. So the real challenge for any IT specialist or the solution architect will be to migrate this data and bring it on a unified common platforms. So as a part of information technology, there have been many data management tools which have been developed, which are open source. You don't have to really leverage on only the commercial off-the-shelf product. You can make use of these open source tools to fetch the data, retrieve the data, and create your own tables, or live you can provide a connectivity to some of these data sources and retrieve the information. So once, if such fundamental basic tools are available, then building smart and safe city is not a major challenge. Now, if it comes to the smart city applications, I would classify the smart and safe city applications under three major categories. One is citizen services, which is basically meant for providing quick service to the citizens. And the second one is infrastructure services. So the infrastructure services basically, it deals with implementation of smart energy and utility systems or communication systems, and also the smart transportation and the smart health information systems. I will just try to give one example under maybe under public safety and infrastructure, citizen service, and I'm not sure whether time will permit or not. So I will touch upon few use case scenarios, basically to give you an idea about what exactly we mean by smart and safe city, and what is that I have been talking about, so many domains, so many incidences. So how really this can be achieved is what the gist of this presentation. Now let me walk you through one smart utility system. You are aware that city-wide there is a fiber network, or it can be a water supply network, or it can be energy network. Let us take the example of fiber optic network. Well, the major problem in fiber network management is to get a unified view of this entire utility network for its monitoring and control the system. So to achieve that, the initiative, again, it was not a part of smart city. It was one of the examples of the systems which are already there in place. Okay, so they already have integrated the fiber optic network with the OTDR, that is basically these are some of the sensors, and RMOPP. Then also the state of the art IT infrastructure is in place. So as and when the fault occurs, fault means there may be cut in the fiber optics. So where exactly, in a given city, where exactly the cut has happened, to trace that manual process is very tedious, and definitely there will be delay in providing a better service to the customers. So keeping that in mind, they have automated this by integrating various systems. So various systems, and I said, of course, the base map required for that would come from satellite imagery, or it can be from any of the mapping agencies, what I just mentioned, or they can access that data and create their own repository, provided they have a permission, and make use of that data. They don't have to create that data. On that, they can superimpose their fiber optic layer, which is their own data, maybe collected using surveying. Then this whole system will be integrated with the ONMS system, and as I said, some of the sensors like RMOPP or intrusion detection systems, etc. What actually these systems they do is, they detect as and when the fault occurs, they detect, they send the exact location of the problem to the control room. So from control room, then they
sir, your voice is breaking, sir.
Density. Okay. So this is an example of how really one can leverage on the geospatial technology and information technology. When here you can see the fault is detected, and this particular fault is shared to the control room. And also as a decision maker, from their perspective, they can visualize how many problems were reported, which are major ones, which are critical ones, one can visualize, and then have some plan in place to prevent the such a faults. So, okay, as I said, this system exists as a standalone. So like this, there are many systems I mentioned, like, you know, other utility systems are also there. And the complexity of these threats that any city faces is a major, major problem for the government agencies. It is not only in India, it is across the globe. So keeping this in mind, state-of-the-art, modern, you know, emergency operation centers are established. And these modern emergency response centers are not addressing only a utility domain, but also addressing the requirement of safety and security of citizens. Plus, most important is the safety and security of these infrastructure also. For example, if there are certain critical infrastructures like dam sites and water reservoirs, the technology which are sensor enabled and integrated with IT systems are already there as a part of smart and safe city. And here in India, good attempts are being made to implement similar approach. What is required to build such a smart and safe city is basically the spatially enabled command and control systems, which are, as I mentioned earlier, integrated with multiple sensors, maybe a CCTV, and at a strategic locations, the emergency response systems. Now, what are these emergency response systems? What are the command and control systems? We'll talk about some of those technologies. And of course, the robust IT infrastructure and communication systems are the backbone for any smart and safe city. Well, now I will walk you through some of the smart and safe city scenarios. Okay. Well, let us say there is an emergency response center established, and some incidents may happen across the city, like there may be leakage of a natural gas. Now, CNG pipeline is laid in most of the cities. Now, if there is any leakage detected, one should be able to send the response team to correct that. Or if there may be a burst in the water pipeline, or it may be there may be flood due to heavy rains, or there may be fire, or in a particular critical infrastructure facility, someone is trying to intrude, or some animal may be trying to intrude. So in such cases, the smart infrastructure, whatever we are talking about, should be such that it should detect these incidences and send an alert to the emergency operation center. Operator received an alert, he will get to see that alert on a geospatially enabled map with a visual video alert, and also the alert manager will automatically open up. So these are some of the core functionalities of command and control system, what I am talking about. So when a particular incident happens in the emergency operation center, they will have a system something like this, wherein, you know, the satellite imagery will be shown in the backdrop, and some thematic layers, depending upon the requirement, they should be able to superimpose. And if there is a camera already installed, that what they call them as a PTZ cameras, these cameras can be controlled from the emergency response center to see what is the situation on the ground. And depending upon the situation, the operator will be able to, you know, communicate that to a next level. So here, when I say next level, for every incident, there will be a standard operating procedure. Now, the command and control system deployed in some places are such that for each and every incident, it will have its own SOP, and they will be able to follow, because operators are not specialized in each and every domain. So the system is intelligent enough to give him the standard operating the procedure. So he will be able to see how critical the alert is and at what time the alert was. And then if it was communicated through mobile or through telephony, he will be able to raise the incidents, and then following the standard operating procedure, he would communicate that to the next level. I will just give maybe a particular example also, I will walk you through. So once the location of the incidents is noted, as I said, they will be able to tilt the camera. I'm not able to stream that video, forgive me for that, because my internet is very slow. Otherwise, I would have shown you some of the video, how really that alert will be visualized in the command and control center. And then he will, after acknowledging the alert, the operator will communicate that to the next level I mentioned. Okay, when he is communicating to the next level, the detailed view, whatever he was seeing, so it's quite interesting, whatever at the time of incidents, see, this will happen in a fraction of a minute. When he was seeing 1 minute back, the same incidents window will be communicated to the response team or whoever is responsible for maintaining that particular incidents, plus the live also. That's how there are two windows provided. One will be a pre 1 minute back when the incidents was reported, what was the status. After 1 minute, what is the live, what is the status. So that live video plus the recorded video, both will be shared with the response team. And also, there is a provision to send a communication through email and SMS, but email and SMS every time people will not be seeing. So there will be an alert also to the response agencies. Okay, now the SOP will have a description of the incidents is collected ground in the sense remotely looking at the videos. And that will be sent to the responders. Now let us say, for example, there is a particular event that was detected at a place. I would take one example, maybe fire. When the fire happens, it is important that information should go to the fire agency. Health department or health response team. So the operator, the moment it is called as a fire and it is identified as a fire, so he will get the SOP only to share this information with the fire department, police department and health department. Okay. So the moment they see this incident, that incidents will be mapped to their own application, wherein once again they will be able to see the situation, and the control room, which is there in the fire department, will escalate it to the dispatcher. Dispatcher, basically the fire fighting engines. So they will see visually, okay, this is where it is. So which is the nearest firefighting engines are available, very good teams are available, that they will see. And also they will try to see where exactly the fire hydrants are. All this will be on a geospatial system. And the dispatcher will also look at, okay, to whom it is sent, how much distance it is, and how many resources are available. All that information they will collect, and then they would dispatch the vehicles to address that response, incidents. Also, while they are on the go, they will be able to visualize what is happening in the in that particular site where the incidents has happened using their mobile. Example of the mobile application through in which they will get an alert with a visual sound, and also they will be able to see a map, so they can guide the driver who is driving the fire engine. Okay, so once if they reach the incident's place, then it's important for the commanding officers in the control room or the decision makers in the control room to see what is happening on the ground, right? So the system is intelligent enough to provide this particular features also, because if everything is geo-enabled, so they will also be able to see the exact situation on the ground. Okay, this is just one use case scenario what I present. Now the next, so there are so many features actually. I'm just skipping some slides because these are some of the functionalities which are required for command and control, but keeping the time in mind, I'm just trying to quickly go through. Okay, now whenever such incidences are reported, now please understand that these incidences are also going to be a part of the database, and over a period of time you are required to analyze why at a given place such incidences are reported. When I say incidences, please think in a broader term. Incidences can be anything. It can be fire, it can be pickpocketing, it can be utility teasing, or it can be bribery, robbery, it can be bomb blast, anything. So whenever such incidences are reported, that incident itself is a one data point. Like that, every day if there are 100 incidences are reported, 100 data sets is what you are getting, which will be used for high-end analysis. When such a data keeps on adding over a period of 1 or 2 years, it will become a big data. And that is what people in the IT domain talk about, big data. For example, just to give an example, in the year 2003, we implemented the state-of-the-art Dial 100 solution at Mumbai. You will not believe, every day the number of incidences that were coming to the police control room, which is now one of the major emergency operation center, were nothing less than 8,000 incidences. So imagine 8,000 incidences per day in a city like Mumbai. So in Bangalore, maybe it will be around 3 to 4,000, and in some other city, it will be around 2,000. And in small town, it may be lesser than that. But over a period per day and day, over a period, this data will grow. And this is one of the major input data for some of the big data analysis. So analytics are used basically to prevent. Okay, if particular, I'm talking very general. Okay, but I will give a specific example. Let us say for a given location, a crime rate is very high. So if police as a part of their strategic plan would assess that, analyze, identify the hotspot areas and try to increase the patrolling so that the further incidences in that particular area can be minimized. The same example, if I have to give in the utility domain, maybe for a given region or a given area, the faults are quite frequently reported. In that case, they will try to analyze that data and see what is the reason, whether it is a topographical issue, problems or a terrain conditions, or it is a man-made, they will try to analyze and then accordingly, you know, they will try to prevent, because always prevention is better than response, right? So this information will be available to any emergency operation center, and all the line departments will be members or users of this emergency operation center. So this is about how really they are going to close. I will just skip some of those slides. But now let us look at a scenario where emergency response systems is there, but systems are there, but they are not state of the art. Only command and control center is there. The sense keep the command and control center wherein the live feeds are being brought in, and those live feeds will be communicated to the response agency. The response agency can be anything. It can be health emergency team, or it can be a police emergency team, or whatever. So earlier, they have implemented some systems. Even such systems exist at Bangalore also, at Delhi also. Most of those systems were traditionally, you know, MIS-based systems, in the sense they were not really geo-enabled. So when the command and control, now also there are some systems in some parts of the country where state of the command and control center has been established. Various sensors have been deployed across the city, and the input received from those sensors, as well as, you know, from the CCTV, that data is coming in. That data, when it comes, literally, you know, operators will be the screen almost 24/7, and if they see some incidents, it will work. So to automate that under the CCTV system, they have brought in what is called as a video analytics. What really this video analytics does is, as and when some incidents happens, let us say somebody has dropped the box on the footpath and just walking the way. That is one particular suspicious activity, right? Somebody is just walking on the street with the box and he's leaving it and going. So now the video analytics is smart enough to detect that particular incidents and send an alert. Look, someone has left a box which is unidentified. Now that information they will be able to share to, let us say, the emergency response teams. Or it may be like, you know, more than 10 people are gathering in a given place. That also can be one of the incidents. So that also will be detected and communicated. Or somebody is trying to, you know, enter the gate. It is a forced entry. So the applicants or the video analytics is smart enough, you know, wherein you can configure, okay, if Mr. X or any object, if it is moving from point A to point B, after crossing point B, it should generate an alert. So that alert also will come to the emergency response center. So when such incidences happens, they would, you know, communicate that to a police control room or any other emergency group. So then they will field team to the place of incidents and take necessary action. So here, when I said they had some system which was not joinable. Vaguely, you know, they would just send the dispatch team. There was a time delay. The response team are not reaching in time because of traffic congestions and not getting the exact locations, so on and so forth. That is where the geospatial technology was brought in, and that was integrated with most of these systems. So what happens now is almost in Bangalore and Mumbai, whenever such incidences are reported, you know, that incidence is automatically raised to the respective emergency response teams, and they will be able to send their rescue team to the place of incidents, right? So, but that is really not a great solution, because the from emergency operation center, they have to communicate to a police control room, then they have to communicate to medical services or a fire brigades, then they will send maybe one by one. So instead of that, now the concept as a part of this emergency response system is to generate an alert at the same time and send it across all the control rooms, whether it is police or a medical or fire brigade. At a time, they will get this alert. So immediately they can dispatch. So there will be a collaboration. There will be a response at the same quick response by all the agencies which are responsible for addressing the situation. Okay, so this is just one use case scenario what I was talking about. The information when the incident occurs, the information is shared to all the agencies and they will dispatch. Now, so when I said traditionally, you know, they were having the MIS based system, and this was the look and feel of that MIS system, where, you know, everything they would enter manually and update their database. But now, as a part of this modern command and control system, based on the alert, most of these database fields will be automatically populated, and with the minimum intervention by the operator, I mean, so that response should happen within 2 minutes or 3 minutes. Though I took so much time to present all this, activity has to be done in just 1 or 2 minutes. Now the new concept that is coming out is this. Whatever particular agency has deployed with CCTV or a sensor, those inputs only would go to their corresponding agencies. And from there, the data sharing will happen. For example, as a part of a safe city, almost in Bhubaneswar, Bangalore, Mumbai, they have implemented only a CCTV cameras. And that CCTV camera feeds comes into the traffic police control room. From there, they will share the information to other agencies. This is quite annoying because of various funding issues, maybe they must have established a limited CCTVs and limited sensors. And also the communication system being used may not be robust. So to overcome this, now the concept is that whatever agency, there are some agencies like private agencies are there who have deployed their sensors, who have deployed their CCTVs, maybe either some of the shop owners have CCTV. Now, all this feed gets automatically, it will be shared with the other agencies. Again, depending upon the type of incident. So now the operator job is only to see what type of incidents and identify that incidents and enter that incident. Once if that incidents is entered, let us say by bursting or water bursting, it has to go to the respective agency. So automatically they will just select that incidents, and the system will generate that SOP and communicate that to the corresponding agencies. Basically, they would get the live web link of their web services, which will provide them the sensor input data or a CCTV data, VGMS data, whatever data they have. Now, once if they have that data, same data, they will be able to see in their emergency response system or a dial 100 system. I'm sure you guys are quite familiar with the dial 100 system. Traditionally, dial 100 systems were meant for, you know, as and when incidents happened, you would make a call to 100, now it is 112, and they will try to locate the incidents physically on a map and see which is the nearest vehicle and then dispatch the vehicle. Now, that kind of manual processing is minimized, you know, because live web link they are getting, they will be able to, you know, see the situation and immediately send the response team. Earlier, control room would have no idea what is happening on the ground. So, but now in the system sitting there in their respective control rooms of their department on a large screen, they can visualize, okay, what is happening, how their response teams are addressing the need. So these are some of the use cases what I wanted to present. So this is the typical, you know, look and feel of this emergency response system, which is only dedicated for smart and safe cities. Now, in addition to this, it will have various other features. Maybe, let us say, from usability perspective, it will have multilingual support, and from decision maker perspective, it will have a dashboard showing number of incidences happened and how many incidences were reported, what was the response time. So basically, to assess the, you know, the quality of the service, what is being provided by your own department. Thus, the overall command and control system being deployed as a part of safe city are not only providing the response in a quicker and a shorter time, but also they are designed to assess the efficiency of the services being provided by the respective agencies. Okay, so these are some of the screenshots of those applications. I thought this is what I just wanted to present. And if you have any specific questions, I think we can discuss further.
Thank you, sir. So there is one question posted in the chat box already by Mr. Rambhupal Reddy. I think, okay. What is the influence of Internet of Things on smart cities in the future?
What is the?
Influence of Internet of Things on smart cities in future.
Well, everything is going to be IoT. IoT have a major role to play in the smart city. But right now, you know, there are very few sensors or IoT devices, I would say. All sensors are not IoT enabled. But once if that happens, really the response time would be much better. I see a very good future for that particular market. It's a special question or academic question I make. In any case, I would have a major role to play in the smart and safe. Without IoT, without, there is no smart city. Okay. And what is that next question? What is the status of NSTI? It's a very good question. Well, NSTI is active, no doubt about it. But, you know, whatever data sharing initially they thought about, that is not happening. Maybe because of various administrative issues, like, you know, thematic maps generated by agency A is not being shared through NSTI. That's why in between they came up with the concept of what you call it as a gateway, NSTI gateway concept, through which you can browse the metadata and see the relevance of that data, and then that NSDI should direct the user to the respective server. That is still at a conceptual stage. No, right now NSDI has got a very limited layers, and they are definitely active. But if you are asking a particular question like, do they have all the thematic layers? Have they really fulfilled the primary objective of NSDI? No, nowhere it is fulfilled, I would say. Very few limited. It's like, you know, pilot project kind of a thing, I would say. Okay. And any questions related to safe city or smart city?
So there's one more question. Do we have a stable SDI in India?
Do we have
a stable SDI in India?
No, that's what I said. SDI and NSDI are both are the same. It is not stable yet. They are trying to stabilize, but it is taking its own time for whatever unknown reasons. The major, you know, the major issue is these data generating agencies comes under different ministries. So bringing them on same platform is a major challenge for them. Of course, they have some systems in place, but a very limited. For example, Karnataka SDI. You know, NSDI, what they did was they wanted all the states to come out with their special data infrastructure initiatives. So there is an agency called Karnataka State Council for Science and Technology, which is very close to your college. There, you know, they implemented a state special data infrastructure, and that was supposed to be connected to the NSDI at the national level. But that has not yet happened. But state level, yes, they can retrieve this information. Now, the similar concept, if really users are interested, one can visit the KSRSAC portal, which is fairly a very good portal, and they have got all the thematic layers required for most of our projects, starting from, you know, land to land cover to parcel boundary, sorry, village boundary, up to village boundary map they have. So they can access that. It is as good as your, you know, a special data infrastructure initiative, at least in Karnataka.
Sir, there's one more person, Dr. Kanagaratnam, is waiting on line to ask the question.
Yeah, please.
Sir, you can go ahead and unmute yourself. Dr. Ratnam? I think there's some issue with
connectivity. Okay, can you?
Okay. Sir, thank you for the wonderful and insightful session. I now thank call you. Upon Dr. Nisar Ahmed to propose the vote of thanks.
Thank you, Rahman.
Thank you, Dr. Bandar, my close friend, for this wonderful presentation, very informative presentation. Especially you highlighted on the technologies for smart and safe sustainable cities, the challenges, CCC, command control center, and then especially about the use cases with the different approaches. So on behalf of Ramaya Technology, so I'm very much thankful to you. So take care. I hope the students community, you know, so definitely with your wonderful presentation, they will get benefited. And then now itself, you know, so there are a lot of the queries are coming. So how we have to approach Dr. Bannur for more details and all. So I am sharing your contacts if you are, so if you are agree with me.
Yeah.
So definitely they will contact for one way or the other, yeah. Queries and all. So thank you once again. So take care. Thank you, sir.
Dear participants, now we'll break for today. We'll take. Okay, one second.
Yes, thank you. It was my pleasure. And if someone has any queries, they can contact me on my email also. Maybe in the first slide, I have given my contact. Any questions, they can contact me. No issues. Okay. And one more thing, if as a part of your research initiative, anybody who is interested in some research activity, they can contact me. I it will be my pleasure to help them out know, whether it is related to our data or application or whatever. Okay.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Our participants will break for today. We'll be joining back at 2:30 for the next session, which is handled by Dr. Nisar Ahmed. So join 5 to 10 minutes early, probably by 2:20 for the next session. Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks, sir. Thanks.